Okay, I got to back up a little bit. This will be pretty quick, and then just to kind of fill in where we are, because I try to keep the flow of what's going on, at least the way I see it. This thing is really wobbled, so if I fall over here, I might be he's fallen and can't get up. That's how it'll be. Calvin, come lift me, though. He'll take care of me. All right, in 520, Paul spoke of God's grace superabounding in the face of the increase of sin that was occasioned by the law. Now, some might think that Paul was thereby implying that we should remain in sin, that we should remain under sin's control so that grace may increase. And then in chapter 6, Paul addresses that idea and says, no, that's crazy. So he quickly says, look, that idea, he rejects it completely and absolutely. Sin will not exercise lordship over us because we're under the new covenant in which we've been separated from sin's power by dying to sin in Christ and being empowered by the Spirit to live for God. So he says that in 6:1-14. Then in 6:15-23, he makes clear that the fact Christians are not under the Mosaic law, the law of the old covenant, doesn't mean they're lawless or immoral. Those aren't the choices. It's not Judaism or immorality. He makes clear that's not the case. On the contrary, they've been freed from sin, freed from those enslaving powers that would prevent us from being the kind of people God wants us to be. We've been enslaved to righteousness. See, we serve God with a new heart. As new people, we serve God wholeheartedly. Chapter 7, 1-6, Paul says, with the Jewish Christians, especially in mind, that through their participation in Christ's death, they were released from the law and joined to Christ, and they now serve in newness of the Spirit, not in oldness of the letter. They live life in the new order, in the new covenant, in the new age, not in the old. And having said that the effect of the law was to increase trespass, as he said that in chapter 5, verse 20, and how sin used the law to arouse sinful passions, he said in chapter 7, verse 5, he explains in chapter 7, verses 7 through 12, that the law is not sinful or evil. See, the law is holy, righteous, and good. The culprit in this is sin, which uses the law to produce death, and that's what we were talking about last week. The end of chapter 7, verses 13-25, Paul clarifies the law's role in death. And he says that though part of him realizes the goodness of the law and part of him longs to obey it, he winds up transgressing the law because sin, or the sinful inclination, that bentness that dwells within him, pulls him into disobedience. Sin keeps that part of him that wants to obey from taking over the mind and will to the extent that it can effectively and consistently direct the body to do what is good. So Paul is saying that. Now, at the end of last class, I gave several reasons why I'm convinced that Paul is speaking here of one's condition outside of Christ, one's condition in Adam, not in Christ. And one of those reasons is that the description of this person as being sold under sin and thoroughly captivated by it is incompatible with Paul's view of life in Christ as he described it in chapter 6. You remember last week I put up the slide that had the four or five sections out of chapter 6 that show that we have been freed to live a victorious life, not enslaved to sin. So that's one of the reasons. There were a couple other reasons that I included. But some commentators object to the view that Paul is here speaking of a non-Christian experience because they claim the mind of a non-Christian is incapable of delighting in God's law and desiring to obey it. Now, I think that's incorrect, that Paul and other pious Jews of his day, that they sincerely sought to do what was required of them. It seems evident to me from Romans chapter 10, verse 2, where Paul says, "For I testify about them," speaking of the Israelites, "I testify about them that they have zeal for God." I mean, it was misplaced. It was there were things they didn't understand. But the notion of sincerity and actually desiring to do good, I think, is not something that's restricted to Christians. Paul's sincerity of faith, it's obvious to me in Philippians chapter 3, verse 6, where he says that with regard to righteousness that was rooted in the law, he was faultless, meaning he was an exemplary Jew. He was somebody who was sincerely seeking to obey, and indeed even some Gentiles obey some of the law of the heart. In chapter 2, verses 14 and 15, that's my daughter walking in right there. You see her? That's my girl. I told him when you came in I was going to have to mess with you. All right. Now, when Paul says in Romans chapter 8, part of what leads to this idea that we'll know the non-Christian can't delight in or desire to obey the law, part of it's a reading of Romans chapter 8, verses 7 and 8. And how I see that is when Paul says, and we're going to get to Romans 8, you're doubting we'll ever do that, but we will. We're going to get to it today. Whether we'll get to verse 8, I don't know. But Paul says in Romans chapter, when he says in Romans 8, verses 7 and 8, that the mindset of the flesh is hostility toward God and is unable to be subject to the law of God, he doesn't mean that non-Christians cannot know or desire the good. Rather, he means that in some, you see, in total, they are innately hostile to God. In other words, considering all aspects of their being, the totality of their being, they're oriented toward themselves and their own gratification rather than toward God and others. So mind and mindset in Romans chapter 8 verses 5 through 8 is broader than mind in Romans chapter 7 verses 23 and 25. And in fact, different words are used. So it's a broader thing. It speaks mind or mindset in chapter 8 speaks of a person's total orientation, not simply that rational part of the person that desires the good. So I think that that's, you know, that there's not an inconsistency there. I think that a non-Christian can desire the good. So I read this when somebody says, I don't think you should take this as speaking of a non-Christian because a non-Christian can't desire the good. I don't think that's correct. So that's all that I was saying in that little part there. Now, it's important, very important in my judgment or view to point out that the fact Paul is here speaking of a non-Christian's experience, that does not mean that Christians don't struggle with sin. I mean, your experience would tell you that right away. So you have to be going, wait a minute now. There's something that doesn't mean that Christians don't struggle with sin. As I've already said on a number of occasions, as long as we live in this overlap of ages, as long as we live between the inauguration of the kingdom at Christ's coming and its consummation at His return, as long as we live there, the new man in Christ continues to be subject to the influences of the powers of the old age. We are pulled. See, we are tempted to live in Adam, and we have to continually resist that temptation because we are in this overlap. And so we're still pulled, and that temptation to live in Adam is ever present. So Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, he warns the saints to abstain from fleshly desires that war against the soul. Okay, why is that? Because I'm a new creation, but I'm still here in this overlap, so I have to exercise that judgment or that power and abstain from fleshly desires that war against the soul, that are trying to pull me to live in Adam. But we do that, you see. We do struggle with sin, but we do that as people who've been freed from enslavement to sin. We fight as people who have been healed from our addiction to sin. We fight and live on a different order, a different plane. We do so in the power of the Spirit, as Paul is going to spend all of chapter 8 talking about. And we do this in the power of the Spirit. As I've said many times, I'm saying again, you see, we are not the same person in a new situation. We are a new person in a new situation. And we have underplayed that too much, in my judgment. The radical change that is part of conversion, that puts us and makes us new creatures, new people, that's an important thing for us to understand. All right, chapter 8, you see we made it to here. All right, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life freed you in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For what was impossible for the law, because it was weakened through the flesh, God did, having sent His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as a sin offering, He condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And you remember that Paul declared in Romans chapter 5, verses 12 to 21, that for those who are in Christ, righteousness and eternal life replace the condemnation and the death that were their lot in Adam. In chapter 6 and 7, he then takes a necessary and important detour. Okay, I think it's right to see it as a detour, but it's a necessary and important detour to explain why that fact doesn't lead to lawlessness, and to defend the claim that Christians are not under the Mosaic Law. In the course of defending his claim and his assertion that Christians are not under the Mosaic Law, Paul said that sin actually used the law. Sin used the law to bring those under. Sin used the law to bring death to those who were under the law. That was all that we were talking about last week. He then, in the last part of chapter 7, as I just was reviewing, in the last part of chapter 7, he explained the dynamics of the process by which sin used the law to kill those under the law, thereby demonstrating that the blame goes to sin. You see, the blame falls on sin, not with the law, which is holy, righteous, and good. Well, in chapter 8, verses 1 to 4, I think Paul is reconnecting with chapter 5, verses 12 to 21, by reasserting the conclusion in light of this detour that he's made, where he said, no, this doesn't lead to lawlessness, and he explains what he's talking about, where you're not under the Mosaic Law. Then he reconnects with this fact that there's no condemnation, and he restates that. He restates that conclusion or that truth. He reasserts the conclusion in light of what he has said in chapters 6 and 7. And this reconnection, I think it's suggested in the overall contextual flow, but I also think it's suggested by the fact the word that he uses, condemnation, that he uses in chapter 5, verse 16 and in chapter 5, verse 18. That word condemnation occurs one other time in the New Testament, and it's in chapter 8, verse 1. So in 5:16, 5:18, you have this word for condemnation. He goes through in 6 and 7, takes this necessary and important detour, and then I think he reconnects, and one of the signals is he uses that word for condemnation that appears three times, 5:16, 5:18, and Romans 8, 1. Okay, so I think that's an indication of some kind of reconnection. But the conclusion of what he said over the last few chapters is that there is no condemnation for Christians. Okay, now you got to let that sink in and love that. You see, there is no condemnation for Christians. The death sentence has been removed. We are no longer alienated from God. We are no longer spiritually dead. You see, we're no longer alienated from God. And we no longer die physically as punishment for our sin. Remember, I went through the whole thing about dying and how there's a difference between dying as a consequence and dying as a sentence and as a punishment. We no longer die as a punishment for our sin, and we no longer face eternal separation from God in the final judgment. There is no condemnation. That death sentence, this full death in the fullest sense, spiritual, physical, eternal, that sentence has been removed. You see, there is no condemnation. Now, Christians are not under condemnation because the principle that applies to them, The principle that governs their situation, he says, is the law of the Spirit of life. See, and in pursuant to that law, they have received righteousness and life. And I think he calls it the law of the Spirit of life. He refers to it that way instead of saying it's the order of God or the purpose of God or the working of God. I think he uses the phrase law for rhetorical reasons because he's making contrast and he's talking about the law. But the idea is that there is this principle that is at work, and as one enters the new age of the Spirit, as one comes under the new covenant, one is freed from the governing principle of the old age, the law of sin and death. In Christ, the former replaces the latter. So this is this idea that as I enter into the new covenant in Christ, I become subject to this new principle, the law of the Spirit of life, and through that I receive righteousness and life. And the shift in governing principles is the result of God's having done what was impossible under the Mosaic law, under the Mosaic law to do, and that humanity was under sin. You see, humanity was under sin and thus couldn't yield the obedience that was necessary for life. So here, if we have these commands here to do, the law as commands couldn't produce life because humanity was under sin, but God did what the law couldn't do. He provided righteousness and life by sending Christ to earth as a human in the likeness, he says, of sinful man to be an atoning sacrifice. And we've heard that idea so many times, you just let it wash over you, but listen to it. To be an atoning sacrifice, and in this sacrifice, God punished sin in mankind. As Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, he was made sin for us. So God has this sacrifice, and he says he does that so that the righteous requirement, which is singular, so that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in those who share in Christ's death. So here we have what the law couldn't do, and that it was weakened because of our sinfulness, that we could not yield or provide the obedience necessary for life. God did by sending his Son as a sacrifice and to provide salvation, but that salvation isn't simply forensic. It isn't simply that we stand as the same person in a new situation. No, no, no. We stand as a new person in a new situation. He says that we did this, see, so that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in those who share in Christ's death. Christ paid the penalty. He paid the penalty for all sins and thus brought salvation that the law couldn't bring. But just as Paul said, you remember in chapter 6, verse 4, where Paul said that our sharing in Christ's death through baptism was that we might walk in newness of life? It wasn't simply that we might be forgiven and be in a forgiven state. No, no, it was that we might be forgiven, of course, freed from condemnation, freed from death, but that we might walk in newness of life, that we might live as in a new state, that we might live in a new state. Well, just as he said that there, so here he says that God's condemnation of sin through Christ's sacrifice was that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in us. And with many others, I think the righteous requirement that he has in mind here, that it's probably the commandment to love your neighbor as yourself. That we've been freed, we've been changed, we've been transformed and put on a new plane, so that righteous requirement may be fulfilled in us who walk according to the Spirit. See, it's in conjunction with our participation in Christ's saving work that we not only are forgiven, but we're empowered by the Spirit to obey the moral norms of the law in a new way, to live on a new plane a transformation that ultimately will end where? In perfect obedience. You see, we've been taken to a different plane, and that transformation, as we're being transformed into the glory of Christ, when He comes, you and I will be like Him. You see, that transformation that we've been put on another plane and we are being transformed into His image, when He returns, we will be like Him. You don't think you'll be sinning in eternity, do you? No, you won't. You see, your sanctification will be completed. Okay, so this is what Paul is talking about. Let me read you a couple of texts here. Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, 13 and 14, "For you were called for freedom, brothers. Only do not use that freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love be slaves to one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, in the command." You remember the righteous requirement, singular? "In the command, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." Sorry about these. When I cut over here, you get these hyphens in here that I didn't pay attention to and left them in there. Okay, says that the whole law is fulfilled in one word, in the command, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." And as Paul makes clear in Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 10, love involves specifics. See, sometimes we take this idea that you shall love your neighbor as yourself, that simply means this kind of amorphous, this idea that it's just all about some kind of feeling and that it has no content to it. It's anything I want to make it. Oh, no, I did that because I love. No, there's real content to love. As Paul says in Romans 13, 8 through 10, owe nothing to anyone. That should have an O on it. I must have been sick when I was doing this. That's O, not we. That's O. Owe nothing to anyone except the well-known to love one another. For the one who loves the other has fulfilled the law. See the fulfillment in us? See, has fulfilled the law. For the well-known, you shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment, it is summed up in this word, in the command, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does not work evil against the neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. So I think this is what he's talking about when he says in us, the righteous requirement. So it is, you see, there is an ethical aspect to our conversion and our salvation. We are different people. We are changed. And that is a very important thing to understand. Those in whom this just requirement of the law is fulfilled, those who've died with Christ in baptism, are described as those who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That's what he says in verse 4, the last clause of verse 4, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. See, to become a Christian means to be transferred from the realm dominated by the flesh to the realm that is dominated by the Spirit. Flesh and Spirit, they stand over against one another. You see, flesh, Spirit, they're over against each other. And so it's to be transferred from one realm to the other. Flesh and Spirit, they're not parts of a person, but they stand over against one another as powers or dominating features of two realms or orders of existence. See, this idea of flesh and Spirit, where he says here, we walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Paul says in Galatians, Galatians 5:16-18. He says, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will in no way carry out the desires of the flesh. You see this side over against each other. He says, for the flesh desires things contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit desires things contrary to the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, so that you may not do whatever you want. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under law. So you see that contrast there that is put there. Douglas Moo, in his commentary on Romans, he says, To walk according to the flesh, then, is to have one's life determined and directed by the values of this world, of the world in rebellion against God. It is a lifestyle that is purely human in its orientation. To walk according to the Spirit, on the other hand, is to live under the control and according to the values of the new age, created and dominated by God's Spirit as His end time gift. You see, I think we've become afraid sometimes of the Spirit and the Spirit's empowerment in a person's life because we fear charismatics. So we've allowed the charismatics to get us to deny the power of the Spirit in a transformed life. And in doing that, we are selling short the truth of Christianity. You see, there is tremendous power. There is freedom. There is a breaking of the bondage to sin. And this is important. And so this is something here that you can see this, where he says, look, that we walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And then he says in 8:5 to 13, for those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For the mindset of the flesh is death, but the mindset of the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mindset of the flesh is hostility toward God, for it is not subject to the law of God. Indeed, neither is it able to be. And those who are in the flesh are not able to please God, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, this one is not of Him. But if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. Now therefore, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you're going to die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the practices of the body, you will live. Okay, Paul says here, Paul is in 8:5 to 13, non-Christians are described as those who are according to the flesh, in verse 5, in the flesh, in verse 8, and Christians are described as those who are according to the Spirit, in verse 5, and in the Spirit, in verse 9. They are in two different realms, two different spheres. This echoes chapter 7, verse 5, where Paul pointed out that Christians were formerly in the flesh. They were formerly in the flesh. Those in the flesh are geared to the things of the flesh. They set their minds, meaning the sum of their direction-determining faculties. They set the sum of their direction-determining faculties on the values of this world. That is their prevailing orientation and commitment. And that mindset, that prevailing orientation and commitment, is one of death. Because that mindset is opposed to God. It does not and cannot submit to God's will because its ultimate orientation is elsewhere. Its ultimate orientation is the flesh, is the world. That's where it is. Now, that doesn't mean that they are as evil as possible or that they cannot recognize or desire the good. Paul desired the good, I'm convinced, when he was in the flesh. But when in the flesh, that desire is overwhelmed by other aspects of one's warped being. You see that one is swamped. So that's what Paul's talking about at the end of Romans chapter 7. Now, nor does it mean that those in the flesh are incapable of obeying any commandments. Instead, it means that their worldly orientation, it spoils any formal compliance they may render to God's will. It spoils any formal compliance. As someone has said, however much a husband may be pleased with his wife's doing what he wanted, it would be spoiled if she were in love with someone else. And you can see how that's true, right? I mean, if your wife loves some other dude, I mean, you appreciate what she's doing, but that would certainly take the edge off whatever she's doing for you. I mean, it's like, well, now it comes from a whole different thing, right? So I think that's kind of the idea. Now, those in this state, they may not consciously sense their hostility to God. I understand that. And they may deny that they're being God, that they are God's enemy. But the fact remains, as James says in chapter 4, verse 4, friendship with the world is hatred toward God. I mean, that's what James says. Friendship with the world is hatred toward God. So when they're oriented this way, and that's where the sum of their direction-determining faculties are tied to the world and the flesh, and this idea in opposition to God, that is hatred toward God. And that's what's happening. That doesn't mean that they would say, oh yeah, I agree with you. But that's the spiritual reality. And it's a mistake to conclude from this inability to please God while in the flesh, that one is unable to respond to the gospel while in the flesh. This is a kind of a side issue. But it's a mistake to think that. The gospel is the power of God for salvation. You see, that word of God includes whatever is necessary to enable its proper acceptance. So when that message is presented, that gospel is presented, people can respond to it from the flesh. They're in the flesh, but that message carries with it whatever is necessary to enable a response. Not to compel, not to demand, but to enable a response. And it's through that acceptance that the convert changes realms. You see, when I embrace that gospel, when I say yes to that gospel, when I convert, I then pass from death to life. I then come from this place of being in Adam, that old man under condemnation, enslaved to sin. I am forgiven and transformed and spirit empowered. I live on a new plane. Now, Christians, those in the Spirit, are geared toward things of the Spirit. Their prevailing orientation, their prevailing commitment is to the will of God. And see, those with such a mindset, they have entered into salvation, and therefore they experience life and peace with God. So this is what Paul's talking about, this radical change, this Spirit-empowered life, this new orientation, this complete shift. Christians are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. In the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in us, the Spirit has entered into and He has taken control of our lives. And we accordingly live in that realm in which the Spirit rules, guides, and determines our destiny. There is no such thing as a spiritless Christian. You know, people say, are you spirit-filled? All right, well, I know this is a buzzword, you know. By that they mean, do you manifest, you know, miraculous things? Typically is what they mean. But every Christian is spirit-filled. If you're not, you're not a Christian. The Spirit of God dwells in Christians. His presence is the key. You see, so yes, you know, are you spirit-filled? Of course I am. That's what it means to be a Christian. I'm spirit-filled. And see, He has an effect on a person. See, though the Christian, he says, though the Christian's body is mortal, he said in chapter 6, verse 12, says in 8, verse 11, it is the Christian's body is still subject to physical death because of Adam's sin. But he says there's no condemnation for us, right? There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Romans chapter 8, verse 1. We have no condemnation, but we still die. Yes, that is not a death of condemnation. That's why I spent all that time trying to explain that. You see, that is not a death of condemnation. That is simply a passage. Now, for the non-Christian, that is part of his sentence. You see, that is the totality of theological death, alienation, physical death, eternal separation. All right, so here in the situation is Christians are still mortal, still subject to physical death. Though that's true, the Spirit who dwells in us, he provides eschatological, he provides end time, eternal life because of the righteousness that has been given to us. That's what he says here. This statement says, but if Christ is in you, the body's dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. You see, he provides this, that he provides this life, that the Spirit. He provides and he gives us this eschatological life because of the righteousness that has been given to us. And this life isn't simply our new spiritual life in the present. That's not all it is. It's not simply our new spiritual life in the presence. God, through his indwelling Spirit, he says, will raise our mortal bodies. How much clearer can he be? He will raise what? The mortal body. The body that is subject to death. This thing, he will raise it. As he did with Christ, whose body came out of the tomb. Did it not? Did Christ's body not come out of the tomb? That's what he's going to do. He's going to raise our, as Paul says, our mortal bodies. He will transform them. Did he transform Christ's body? Indeed he did. Why? He's no longer subject to death. Was he subject to death? Yes, he was subject to death. When he comes out, resurrection, is he any longer subject to death? No, he's not. That is what's going to happen to us. That's why Christ is called the first fruits. That's why he says that we're going to be like him and many other things. But he says here, look, that the Spirit, not simply do we have new life now, but he says that life is not simply our new spiritual life, but God, through his indwelling Spirit, is going to raise our mortal bodies from the dead. And so you see this here, which is an important element. And because we're in the Spirit, we're no longer obliged to live according to the dictates of the flesh, no longer obliged to live according to the powers of the old age, in opposition to God. But our rescue from the realm of the flesh, that hasn't removed us from contact with and influence from the flesh. I keep saying that to you because you live it. You live this overlap of ages. You live that we are new, we're spirit empowered, we live on a new plane, but we're in this overlap where what's happening? We're still being pulled and tempted to what? Live in Adam, live in the old man. And so that's what, again, Peter, 1 Peter 2:11, abstain from fleshly desires that war against the soul. And though we no longer belong to it, we have a continuing relationship to the old realm, and we can still heed the voice of the flesh. That's what Paul is doing in so many of his letters. He's trying to encourage and instruct people not to succumb to that, to live like what you are, to live consistently with what you've been given. Now, the structure of verse 12, which I know we're not going to have time to do this, but the structure of verse 12, he says, we're debtors not to the flesh to live according to it. Well, that leads one to expect Paul's going to follow with something like, but we're debtors to the Spirit to live according to him. So he says here, look, we're debtors not to the flesh to live according to it. And you're expecting, okay, no, but instead we're debtors to the Spirit to live according to him. But Paul breaks off and he changes the structure here. He does this. He abandons that structure to warn his readers. And he said, look, if they live according to the flesh, if they fall back into a lifestyle of the flesh, if they go to living like a non-Christian, they will die in the full theological sense. They will be lost. If they go back to that, they will be lost. On the other hand, if they continue to put to death the misdeeds, literally says the practices of the body by the power of the Spirit, they will have full spiritual life. You see, you cannot go back and live like what you were. If you go back and live like what you were, if you do that, if you fall back into that lifestyle of the flesh, you will die. So, you know, I don't understand. Sometimes we talk about, we call people to holy living. You know, there's this idea in Christianity, just, well, you know, we're just no different. We're no different, you know. We're all just lost people, sinners, and there's no difference between you and me except I have grace. I understand the motivation of that. But I think it's misleading to people, and it undercuts the truth that you are not the same person. Now, you can't deny that. And when you tell someone, no, there's no difference, no difference. The only difference between us is that I'm over here forgiven, and you're here, and you're not forgiven. Well, it's true that I'm forgiven, but I'm not the same person. The church ought to be a paragon of holy living. We are empowered to live that way. You ought to be able to look at the Christian church and say, whoa, what is it with these people? Look how they live. Look how they love. Look how they sacrifice. Look how they serve. Now, you think that won't have testimony? You think that's not part of why the church in the early days exploded? Because people saw the power of the Spirit that was manifested in the lives of people. That's how we're to live. Don't think I didn't hear that bell. I heard that bell. All right, thank you.